Now, those signs have been there for, I would say, 1 to 2 weeks. So it appears as if the rental market has dried up in September in Cairns. Quite extraordinary. Big turnaround from what I experienced when it was almost impossible for me to get a place to stay. So it just shows you how things can vary by region. This sort of backs up the fact that things are pretty quiet up here at the moment. Even the PJs, the money-making hotel that it is, they're not getting particularly good crowds at night at the moment. Their patronage has dropped off, and they're just not filling the place at night. And I was quite amazed to find that out yesterday. So there may have been some 33% increase in domestic flights and 13% foreign flights up here earlier, but looks as though right now things aren't exactly booming up here. Well, it's their loss, I love it, but and the real estate market apparently is fairly flat too, so not that it worries me, because you know, I may well buy a place up here, and it means I'll get it at a decent price. I think the future here's good. It could be just a blip on the radar for Cairns. We'll see. Okay, I thought I'd continue on my little rave about real estate and the like in the confines of the rear of the property here. Nice scenery, to say the least. Perfect day for a bike ride. Unfortunately, I'm too bloody lazy to get on my old rust heap and go down the bike track or whatever. I probably should. I'll have to do it soon because it's been a while. I'm feeling pretty guilty about it, and I do feel good after having a ride. But just couldn't be stuffed at the moment, just a bit lazy. I head down to the pub a little later and have a few Guinnesses, and that'll be it. Watch a bit of football. Lazy Saturday. But I was going to mention the getting back to the topic of real estate, and you know how soft the market now seems. I mean, it's just absurd to think that they, real estate agents, are having to put banners out the front of the property on renting to try to entice tenants. It's just totally different to what the market was in May. So I guess as the year drags on, it's going to get even worse as the weather gets hotter. So they'll be really desperate to fill rooms then. So yeah, it could get pretty ugly. So it just shows you how cynical that market is up here. But from my own perspective, you know, as a tenant, I've had a bit of a rough run, and I didn't have the stove for 2 months. That was the worst thing, and I had a noisy neighbours upstairs, and you know, just a few little hassles here and there. But that's all sorted now, so things are really good here. Marie upstairs has been pretty good overall. The architecture doesn't allow the place to be isolated from noise. It's just, that's got nothing to do with her, it's just bad design. And but she's pretty considerate. She doesn't make noise late at night, and you know, I couldn't ask for better personally. So that's worked out really well. My latest hassle's actually been as a landlord. I mean, I've got both Guernseys on, not just the tenant Guernsey, which is a recent one for me, but also still got that landlord Guernsey on. And the hassle's been that I found out that my real estate agent, unbeknownst to me, had actually signed up my tenants down in Melbourne in the flat I own for a 9-month lease. Now, I never mentioned 9 months to her at any stage. She made an executive decision and signed a 9-month lease with them. My signature's not even on that document, so I don't even know if it's legal what she's done. Presumably she knows what she's doing, she's covering her ass that way, but at no point did I mention that. What I said to her is I want a 6-month lease with the possibility of extensions. Now, it wouldn't be such a big deal, apart from the fact that I don't trust her now, but the bigger hassle is that I wanted to sell my property prior to Christmas. Now, I could still do that even with the tenant there, but I've been advised by the real estate agent that I'm going with, who seems to be pretty straight down the line and very enthusiastic, She said to me, you're better off having vacant possession so you can present the property better. But that's not the only issue. The other issue is that if you have vacant possession of the property you're selling, then you can conduct inspections at any time you like. Currently, because there's a tenant there, and tenants do have rights these days, you can only have a certain number of inspections per week. I think it actually might only be one. Or maybe it's up to the discretion of a tenant to have one other. I don't know. I thought it would be two, but apparently it's one. Now, that does restrict your marketing for the sale of a property. And if I've got a good real estate agent who's conscientious and is going to work hard at selling the place, well, I think it's best I put on the market when I've got the opportunity to present it properly for prospective buyers. In other words, not have a tenant in there. So I'm going to have to wait till February now, rather than doing it before Christmas, which would have been a bit of a rush, I admit. And I would have had to have still had inspections there while the tenant was in. The current plan is that I've got back to the real estate agent I want to sell with, who is not the same as the one I'm renting from, I might add, because I just, I'm almost thinking of actually ditching them as doing my property management, because I just think that the way they did that 9-month lease without my knowledge just really has undermined any trust I have. So now what I'm thinking of doing is actually now postponing the sale until February next year. So it'll be an autumn sale, and that's not such a bad thing. I don't want to delay it any longer because I am concerned about the oversupply of apartments in Melbourne. And that may not be a major issue because it seems like the economy's doing better than people might have thought it would. So that's good. But, you know, it's really hard to say, basically. But I just don't want to have to worry about renting a place and I'm living up here. And chances are I will buy a property up here. And the market, you know, being soft up here for real estate could be a good opportunity to buy anyway. So, you know, that's the plan. But I'm just staggered that this real estate agent did that. I find, you know, I think it's at best it's pretty unethical and may even be illegal. I don't know, but I presume, like I said, she's not going to do something like that and jeopardize her career. So presumably they can actually make those decisions. I find it extraordinary. But anyway, that was so I've got it up the rear end that way, as well as the situation with tenancy. So that wasn't so great. But you know, the move up here has been fantastic. I haven't met many new people because I've been basically just going to the pub, and I've been keeping to myself to a large extent. So I can't blame Cairns for that. But I'm very content here, and you know, it's a great lifestyle. And and I'm heading off to Vietnam in about 6 weeks, and I always enjoy that. There'll be over 3 weeks there, and I think I've got myself a really good apartment through Airbnb in the part of Saigon that I really like. But prior to that, I'm going to stay in a hotel that I've been meaning to stay at for about 3 nights, which is right in the centre of town near the BITS Texco Tower, which is right in the CBD area, the business area of Saigon. It's also close to my favourite bars. They're only about a block away, so it'll be walking distance for the first 3 days there. After that, it'll be staggering distance, and I'll probably get a lift on one of the motorbikes. I think I'll do the usual thing. Maybe the same guy that I used last year still hanging around there. He's probably got nothing better to do. He's he's a bit long in the tooth, so I guess his skill levels aren't that great. But you know, it's a win-win for both of us. He's happy to get the fare off me on a regular basis, and I'm happy to help him out. And he's a bit of a character, and I think he's reasonably honest. So you know, he's never done anything that I can complain about. So, oh, the other thing about the flat that I actually rented for 3 months, three weeks. The one that I got through Airbnb, the woman who owns it or rents it out, she actually offered to give me a free lift from the airport. Unfortunately, of course, I'm not going to her place straight away. I'm going to the hotel before that 3 nights. So she withdrew that offer as soon as she found that out. So, but that was nice of her to at least offer. So I didn't expect that. So. Normally they charge $20 apparently for that, and that's actually a little higher than what you'll get just getting a taxi yourself. It usually should be about $12 or something like that, equivalent. Although it will be a nighttime job, so I won't be getting in probably till about 11. But anyway, I'm really looking forward to it, and I've got a convoluted return back to Cairns via Denpasar. I've never been to Indonesia, and I'm actually not going to stay overnight, but I am going to have a whole day there, so I'll get hire a car driver for the day, and it can take me around to the sites, and I'll get the flight late at night and flying back to Cairns. And that brings up another point too. One thing I've noticed since I've come up here is how the airfares have been rising. I mean, it doesn't surprise me that Qantas has made a massive profit, because I'm under the impression that we are lacking competition in the domestic airline market at the moment. The only competition really for Jetstar to fly up on this route to Cairns seems to be Tiger Air, and they just don't have that many flights. I have used them a couple of times, and they've been fine. I think they're slightly better than Jetstar, to be honest with you. But the airfares have definitely crept up, so much so that actually my next flight down to Melbourne, I decided to fly Qantas, because the Qantas flight's only about $10 more than the Jetstar flight. So why would you fly Jetstar? You get the Qantas when you get your luggage allowance, you get your seat allocation thrown in, and you get yourself a meal and drinks. So it's a no-brainer, really, is it? I mean, just for $10, you're way ahead doing it that way. It means I get in late at night, but that's not a major issue. So, yes, but the flight actually from Denpasar to Cairns, which is only a little over 4 hours, is going to cost me $300. And that brings up another beef I had with my old friends at the Jetstar. When I actually went onto the pay screen on the booking, doing the booking online, it quoted me in US dollars. Now, I'm wondering if that's even legal as well. I mean, I've got a couple of legal questions in this particular rave, because every other time you're quoted, especially when you've got to pay on your credit card, in Australian dollars, which makes sense. Well, why would you? It's an Australian company. The transaction's being run within Australia. It may be a flight from Bali to Cairns, but I still don't quite understand why it would be done that way. I mean, the flight from Saigon to Bali is in Aussie dollars, so why the hell is the flight from Denpasar to Cairns quoted in US dollars? So the thing that pissed me off, you don't know how much you're paying until you actually get the bill, and that wasn't cheap. It was about $360, I think, all up, and that's a bloody expensive rate from an Asian country, which should be cheap. It should be a very cheap leg. It should cost a third of that. If there's competition, it would be down to a little over $100 normally. I'm getting gouged about $360, so is it any wonder that Qantas is doing well? When they're charging exorbitant amounts like that, simply because there is no competition. Hopefully that situation will change in the near future. Cairns does seem to be getting more and more flights as time goes on. It seems a logical gateway to Asia from here, seeing we're so close, but I guess we just don't have the population. It's only 150,000 people here. Mind you, I can get a fairly cheap priced direct flight to Japan. Maybe I'll do that some stage, because getting back from Saigon to Cairns is a convoluted situation going through Asia. It's just as easy to fly straight back to Melbourne and then get the flight from the hub down in Melbourne back to Cairns, which is absurd. And it cost me probably less doing that, even though I'm going to be in the air longer. Now, that's totally illogical itself, considering the amount of fuel used, but that's just the way it is because of, there's competition on those other legs. So that's a little insight into that that bit of marketing, the airline marketing, and it definitely is affecting my bottom line, because I'm flying back to Melbourne regularly, and I've got a relatively cheap flight just before Christmas. I'll spend probably a week or so down there over the Christmas break. Probably be fairly humid and not that pleasant up here at that stage anyway, but time will tell. So that's where I stand there. The only other bit of news, I guess, is about the stock market, which tends to always baffle me. We've had some pretty good economic news in Australia this week. It doesn't seem to have helped the stock market one iota. I bought Telstra shares and they kept dropping after I bought them. That seems to be the way. You buy shares and you think you got them on the downward spiral, but you can never get the lowest price. It's almost impossible to snare it. So I paid a little more than I should have. Logically, I would have thought that their price should be actually going up because Telstra are doing a buyback of shares, which should actually improve the returns on the shares, which has got to be good for shareholders. So they will bounce at some stage, but they're incredibly cheap at the moment. So if you've got some cash to spare, you can pick up some pretty cheap Telstra shares at the moment, and they're paying over 6%. Then, and they're fully franked. So, you know, it's a very good return at the price at the moment. So, you know, for someone like me as a conservative investor, that's very attractive. I've probably got far too many in that particular stock and I need to diversify, but I'll do that in when the market improves, not right now. So fingers crossed that all works out well, but just happy to get rid of most of my Woolies shares. That they've gone tanked really big time after they went ex-dividend. They've really died in the backside. So very good move to get rid of most of my holdings of that. So no qualms about making that decision. So it's been pretty good overall, everything here. I have definitely fallen on my feet coming up here, and you know, it's still amazing that people don't use these sort of facilities. But then again, there's at least two vacant flats in this block of properties, and there may be more. So the only thing is that there's constant noise coming from the neighbours over on that direction, which is where my apartment actually balcony faces out that way to a private house, and they seem to have constant work going on in their backyard, and it's noisy, you know, like pounding on bloody weatherboards and metal and all sorts of garbage, and it's pretty bad. And noise is just something that seems to happen everywhere in Cairns. Even the bloody the birds and the trees can be noisy. I've got that on one of my little short YouTube videos, which you'll get to see soon. So just noise and Cairns seem to be synonymous. But probably fairly quiet today because they've got the big race meeting. It's about 8 kilometres away, called the Amateurs, and it's a 2-day carnival and finishes today. And I think only it's about 8 kilometres out of town. And one of the managers, Sally, an English girl who's been about 3 years, she took a helicopter there, and I thought, geez, 8 Ks, how long would it take you to get that far? Apparently it's about, you know, 8 minutes or something. So I suppose you get a nice view for the short trip, but I bet she paid through the nose for that. But I guess it's one of those rare occasions when people can glam up and party on for a while, because there's not that much happening here. A lot of sporting events, but not really big social occasions like that. Tempted to check it out myself, but I'm planning on being here for a while, so I might be able to see it next year. See how we go. So that's about it. It's all good. Happy that I can reschedule the sale, and probably better that I've done that. And disappointed to find that my agent's a bit not exactly straight shooter, but you know, that she's not the first real estate agent to be a bit like that. So a cautionary tale, I guess. So the next video I might do is on something totally different, which will be more space science, deep space exploration, and the best rocketry to use. So that'll be a change of pace. Okay, hope you enjoyed this, and catch you soon.